Let's open our Bibles, Psalm 68. Let's read the first part of that verse. Psalm 68. God sets the lonely in families. Friends, just imagine yourself to be in an island, alone. You have everything that you need in life. You have the best house. You got the best car. You get the best food. But you are alone. Do you think that you'll be happy? Do you think that you will enjoy your life? Do you think that you will be fulfilled in the things that you're doing? Friends, I don't think that anyone would want to be in that position. You know why? Because you will be lonely. Because we are created, friends, to have a fellowship with one another, a desire to fellowship with one another. Even from the beginning, that was the design of God. You know why? Because when He created the heavens and the earth, after creating things, God would say, and it was good. Everything that God created was good. But He said something that was not good. And that is Genesis 2:18. It is not good for a man to be alone. Friends, there is the desire in our hearts to fellowship. And so, how did God initially respond to the loneliness of Adam? How did He respond? Because He saw that it was not good for a man to be alone. And so God created the animals, the birds of the air, and He gave them to Adam to be a company to Adam, hoping that Adam will be blessed by all these newly created things. But friends, there was none that could satisfy the longing of Adam for fellowship. Because the longing, friends, is to fellowship with someone just like you. See, our longing is to fellowship with someone that just like us. Not with animals. See, material things would not satisfy us. Regardless of how many you have, it won't satisfy. Friends, imagine yourself coming home one day. And you are so blessed at your work. You just got your promotion, becoming the president of the company. Going home and then finding no one at home. Going to an empty home. You think that you will be fulfilled? You think that you will enjoy your promotion? You need someone to share your joy. You need someone to share everything that you have as a blessing. That's why it's so important for us to have a family. Amen. It's so important for us to have a family. So if you have a family now, appreciate your family today. Well, there is that song that says, a house is not a home. When there is no one there to greet you when you go home. So friends, we need each other. That's why we are told that God sets the lonely. Are you lonely? Then you are in a home. He sets the lonely in families. Families, plural. Not just your own family now, that small family that you have. But God sets you in families. So that if one fails, the other will take over and give you and bring you the peace that you want or the fellowship that you long. That's why we are set in families. Amen. So we are to walk together and enjoy life together. So from the beginning of time, that was the plan of God. And of course, we know, friends, that if you are lonely, your immediate response is to go to your family. Amen. I just can't imagine Sister Rose enjoying her time in Israel without a family in Israel. Amen. When I was asking her, how did you feel when we left you? in Israel. And said that, you know, Pastor, the moment that you left, because the one, the member of her family that was supposed to be with her, was not there yet. She said that, you know, the moment that you left, as if everything crumbled, you know. She was so lonely, so alone, not knowing what to do. But when the member of her family appeared, there was joy. Amen. See the beauty of being part of a family? That someone can be with you in times of trouble. That's why in Proverbs 17, verse 17, we are told. Proverbs 17, 17. A friend loves at all times. And a brother is born for adversity. A brother is born for adversity. What do you mean by brother born in adversity? Or for adversity? Meaning that we are born for one another. We are born for us to be available and ready to help someone that will be in adversity or that will be in trouble. We are born for that. Amen. So if you're thinking, what is your role in a family? Your role is to be a blessing to your family because you are born for adversity, not only in good times. Not only in good times, where we can be together in good times and rejoice in good times. No, especially in those most difficult times that we need each other. Amen. We are born for that, friends. We are born for that. We are born for adversity, and we are also born in adversity. What do you mean by born in adversity? When you and I find yourself in problem and no one else to help, suddenly a brother is born. Amen. You know, there is a good example that we have, born in adversity, a brother born in adversity. You know, sometimes you don't appreciate him, but he is a brother born in adversity. This is our counselor, Cho, Raymond Cho. When we were so in need of help, when we were so desperate, we didn't know what to do with this building. Suddenly he appeared. We did not look for him. We did not go to him and say, Counselor, can you help us? No. Suddenly he appeared in that moment. He was born in adversity. Then we found a brother in trouble. In times of trouble, we found a brother. And they said, here I am. How can I help? And he helped us. Friends, we are born for adversity, and we are born in adversity. And so let's encourage one another. Amen. So who is your brother? Who is your sister? Where is the family that the Lord is talking about here? In Galatians 6, I think it's verse 10, we are told to be good, especially to the members of God's family. Amen. That's why in Matthew 12, from verse 46, this is what the Lord is saying here. Matthew 12, verse 46. Jesus set the example here. Verse 46, while Jesus was still talking to the crowd, his mother and brothers stood outside wanting to speak to him. Someone told him, your mother and brothers are standing outside waiting to speak to you. He replied to him, who is my mother? And who are my brothers? Pointing to his disciples, he said, here are my mother and my brothers. For whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother and sister and mother. Friends, who is your mother? Who is your brother? That was the question asked of the Lord Jesus Christ. And he said that these are my brothers, these are my sisters, these are my mothers. Whoever does the will of my Father is my brother my sister, and my mother. Amen. That's why we become one. That's why we are a family, because now we are brothers and sisters in the Lord. From someone who is so alone, so lonely, the Lord brought us into a family where we now have a lot of brothers, a lot of sisters, and a lot of mothers. That's why we call so many nanas and tatas here. Suddenly, you find yourself with a brother. This is so important, friends, especially to us who came from the Philippines, who came from other countries. We left our own families to come here. And some of us, we don't have any other blood relatives here. But God had given us a big family. Amen. And so let us be part of that family. Let us bring joy to that family. Let us bring strength to that family. Friends, there is no such thing as a perfect family. Not my family. You come to my house, you could see a lot of imperfection in my house. My children, so much imperfection to me, so much imperfection as a husband, as a father. So much imperfection. But friends, at the end of the day, we are still a family. Amen. At the end of the day, we still love one another. If someone comes to fight me, my children will be ready to defend me. My wife will be ready to defend me. Why? We are a family. Amen. Yes, there will be times when there shall be problems. As I said, there is no such thing as a perfect family. There will be struggles. There will be contentions in the family. There are even jealousies in the family. Just ask my children. There are jealousies in the family. But friends, still we love one another. Still we unite as a family. Amen. We don't fight, we don't kill each other. We are a family. So treat your own family like that. Bless children, bless your dad. Bless your mom. Amen. No one else should go and defend them but you. See, even if your dad is a drunkard, he's still your dad. He is still your dad. Amen. Even if your mom is not the best of the moms, he's still your mom. You know, I'm amazed when I look at children, small kids. The best always, as far as these kids, would be their dad. My dad is the best. And look at the dad. This is the best dad. But as far as that kid is concerned, the dad is the best. The mom is the best. Oh, my mom is the best cook. Even if the mom would be the one just to finish the food herself, because no one else would like the food. But as far as the son or the daughter is concerned, mom is the best. Amen. The mom is always the best. As far as the mother and the father is concerned, friends, their kids are the best. Don't come and try to criticize the children. Friends, they will be the first to defend the children, because they are a family. Amen. And so with us, as a spiritual family, a bigger family. The Lord planted us in families. There's so many families here. Amen. Let's come together. Encourage one another. Let's rejoice with those who rejoice. Let's grieve with those who grieve. Friends, let's carry each other's burden. That is the purpose of a family. Just imagine Adam alone with so many animals around him. Friends, there was no joy in his heart. He was looking for someone that he can have true fellowship. And that's the case too when we got saved. When we were born into God's family, when we became a believer, when we were born again, suddenly in our own home, a home that is nobody else had received Jesus Christ before us, we were the first to be saved in that family, suddenly we find so much loneliness. We are so alone. We need to fellowship with someone that is like us in the spirit, where we can commune, we can share our blessings, where we can go and be in one spirit. When we talk about spiritual things, friends, and you are talking to someone that is not spiritual, you are so alone. You are so alone, as if you are out of this world. And you look for the family. You long to have someone that can just be with you. And God provided us with a family. Amen. So let's enjoy our time together as a family. No bickering, no fighting. There is unity, there is joy, there is love. Amen. At the end of the day, friends, at the end of the day, we need each other. We need each other. As I was telling you last time, Sister Rose, there is this one sister that was there, neglected or often forgotten. But when the time came for us to be in the situation where we need someone to bless us, there was a member of the family that was there. You know, when I was so comforted with this brother back in the Philippines, you know, when Brother Adolf was buried, 3 or 4 days later, we went to the, not to the hospital, but to the cemetery, just to visit the grave. We didn't know, you know, we had no idea. We just had some, maybe there's a tree beside it, or maybe there's a lamppost. And we were so clueless on where he was buried, because now all the signs were no longer there. So we were looking for the grave. And so we parked, and suddenly, friends, we saw someone, and from a distance we could recognize the man. A very lowly member of a spiritual family. Many neglected him, many sometimes avoided him. He has infirmities, physical infirmities. He cannot walk properly. And he is a bit retarded. But he is a member of our family, a faithful member. He would always go with us. You know, we have moved locations in the Philippines, and he would always move along. Always be there, just enjoying, you know, the fellowship. But people sometimes avoid him, because sometimes he would ask. No, he got no job, of course, because of his situation. And he would just be relying on help from brothers and sisters. And there are so many that are generous, giving him every week. But from a distance, we could see this man, and we could recognize by the way he walked. And he had a piece of paper in his hand. And we were looking around for the tomb, and then we saw this man. I don't know if you know him, but if you've been to the Philippines, his name is Kaloy, our brother Kaloy. But he was always in the church. And here was the man, no car of his own, he would take the bus, living far. We found him in the grave, you know, in the cemetery. And he had a piece of paper, and that was the sketch of the whole of the cemetery. And he was looking, doing this way, looking around, looking and trying to find the grave. Friends, who would expect him to be there? Who would expect him to be there? But he said, no, I'm a member of the family. I'm a member of the family. They used to have a good time together with Brother Adolf. And he showed it, friends, not only through his words, because at that time Brother Adolf was giving him something. Now Brother Adolf is gone. But this man never forgot this brother. And he was looking for his grave. And so we found this. Kaloy, did you find it? No, I'm looking for it. I have a piece of paper. I said, here. He could barely read, friends. But the guy in the office is saying that it's here, it's somewhere here. And friends, we look at it, And he was standing right beside the tomb. Because there was no tombstone yet, nothing. Now, no mark at all. And there was no grass yet. And he was saying that, he was complaining now. He said, they did not tell me that there is no Bermuda yet. You know, Bermuda grass. They did not tell me that there is no Bermuda yet. I was looking for a tomb or a grave that has Bermuda or grass already. No, because they were still waiting for for the soil to sink. And so this man was there, showing his love even to the dead. Friends, how many of us would do that sacrifice? And we ask him, how did you come here? I walk. Friends, he could barely walk. He was walking this way, and yet he walked. I took the bus there and walked from there to here. Friends, a family, a member of a family. So let's care for one another. Amen. Let's love one another. We have our own faults. We have our shortcomings. I have a lot of wrinkles. But you can help me overcome the wrinkles by bringing joy. Amen. See, I have a lot of wrinkles. You know, sometimes, you know, all the wrinkles would come. But if you just come to me and encourage me, then I would smile and it will stretch my face. I don't need, what do you call that? Facial. I don't need to go through those stage process, friends, of trying to beautify myself. Because I have you beside me to help me overcome all this. Amen. That's the beauty of a family. So let's appreciate our family. Your own small family and our big family, let's appreciate and be a fruitful and a good member of that family. Amen. And so, friends, when Jesus came 2,000 years ago, he came to bring us together as a family. He is the leader. He is the head of our family. If there is any complaint, you go to the head. God, even in our own families, He ordained leaders in our own families. We have the leadership of our daddy and our mommy. And then after mom, we have the elders. See, there are hierarchies in families. But remember that Jesus is the head. So if you have complaints, go to the head. Go to the Lord. Amen. Express your hearts to the Lord. I complain over this brother, over the sister. I have complained over my pastor. We have our own faults, friends. We have our own shortcomings. When I look at you, I look at you that way. I am not looking for perfection in you. Amen? I'm not looking for perfection in you. But I do everything that I could do for you to be perfect. Amen? That's what the Bible is talking about here. Jesus said that, be perfect for I am. Perfect. That's why we have the word to convict us, the word to instruct us, the word to teach us things. That we can be just like him. Just like the Lord Jesus Christ. He is perfect and we shall attain that perfection too. Yes. Yes, we have our weaknesses. But let's not use our weaknesses as a defense for our actions. For our attitude. Don't always say that, well, the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. Always using the flesh as a reason for not moving on. It cannot be. Amen. We are born again. We are born again. And so, let's move on. Let's walk. Let's keep in step with the Spirit. That He may bless us. That the Lord may bless us. Amen. And so, look at your brother now, your sister. Say, you are a blessing, brother. You're a blessing, sister. Amen. And the families that are here. tell your wife. Tell your wife or your husband, there is none like you. Praise the Lord. There is none like you. Wow. Wow. We are a big, happy family. Amen. Praise the Lord. That should be our attitude always. We are a big family. Come together. Come on, let's go. Amen. Let's celebrate together. Well, as we said, there should be no contentions among us, because in Romans 12, verse 15, we are told, rejoice with those who rejoice, mourn with those who mourn, live in harmony with one another, do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. Amen. This is the instruction of the Lord for us. Amen. Let us be willing to live with those who are in low position. Let's not leave ourselves beyond measure. All of us, we are the same, friends. We are all the same before God. We all need the Lord. We are all saved by grace, just by the grace of the Lord. Let's stand up and let's pray.